Welcome to Psychic Social, brought to you by psychic.co.uk.
On this episode of Psychic Social,
we actually plan what we want to do. So when we're down here with our blueprint of what we aim to do, our guides have got that blueprint. And if we're way off course, like I was when I had my road accident, which is a whole nother story, they will pull you back and change your life completely.
Welcome to Psychic Social with me, Oliver Duke, the podcast that explores all things from the psychic and spiritual perspectives, including interviews with famous psychic practitioners, discussions about the afterlife, the paranormal, and much more. So relax and enjoy the show. Now, today's guest has been a psychic medium for nearly three decades. Since 2005, she's been travelling the UK and Europe, sharing her amazing gift. She's toured with the likes of Colin Fry, shared stages with Most Haunted's Derek Acora. She's also featured on many different radio shows and recorded two series of Angels with Gloria Honeyford. She's been on Come Dine With Me, live from Studio 5, and featured in the Sky documentary, A Sister's Loss. She's a triple columnist as a psychic detective in Fate and Fortune magazine and writes Diary of a Psychic in Spirit and Destiny magazine, both here in the UK and in Australia. She also freelance writes for many other spiritual magazines. She can be seen tutoring throughout the country in workshops and residential spiritual retreats. The lady I'm talking about is the one and only Nicky Alan. Hello, Nicky. How are you today?
I am very well and all the better for being here speaking with you, Oliver.
Oh, thank you very much. I really appreciate that. It's lovely to have you on the show.
It's great to be here. I'm really chuffed.
How are you today? What have you been up to?
Do you know what? Everybody's going to be totally bored with this answer because I've just had flu for the last 2 weeks and today I'm being really lazy. And if you really need to know, I'm sitting in my pyjamas because I haven't bothered to get dressed today because I've been wrapping presents and catching up.
Oh, I see. You've been getting ready for Christmas in your pyjamas, yeah.
It's lucky that this isn't a visual thing. People would be seeing me sitting here in my Christmas PJs, which isn't a good look.
No, we don't have the cameras on at the moment, do we? So we can't see.
Thank you.
Well, like I say, it's lovely to have you with us today on Psychic Social. So my first question was to you, we wanted you to sort of take us back to the beginning in terms of you being a psychic. How did you become a psychic? Well, was it passed down from a family member or a mother or a grandmother? Or was there another way the gift came to you?
We're kind of like the wizards and the witches of the world, because everybody else we deal with deem them as muggles, to be honest with you. I think at least seven or eight generations I can go back now. With psychics in the family. There's a phenomenon that most people that know about spirituality know about, the seventh son of the seventh son. And so my granddad, there's always been a seventh son of a seventh son, and my granddad was a seventh son of 14 children. And we all have the gift. It's more stronger down the paternal line, which is the granddad I'm talking about. And most of my aunties, uncles, my brothers, my nieces, my nephews have all got the gift in one way, shape or form. The main part is being a medium, having visions, psychic visions, seeing people that have passed over, messages from angel realms. Also, my aunties and uncles use tarots, crystal balls. So basically, we grew up with, you know, my granddad looking at tea leaves in a cup.
Right, okay.
And I always thought that the things that I saw, the dreams I had, the things I predicted as a young child, everybody could do. I just thought that was a natural thing. Mm-hmm. The big time when it hit me, when I knew that I was very different, was 3 days after my dad died in a road accident when I was 9 years old. And I was out walking with my auntie, because obviously all the family around the house, because he had just passed, he was only 38. And he drove past in a car and stopped. Don't ask me how that happened. I don't know. But he sat there and said to me, "I'm okay, Nick, don't worry." And he put his thumb up.
Wow.
And so you can imagine, as a nine-year-old child, I've gone running back home, absolutely angry, distressed, because everybody told me my daddy had gone to heaven. And I'd just seen him in a car and he'd stopped and talked to me.
That's amazing.
My auntie didn't obviously see a thing. How he manifested that, I don't know. And then that's when my granddad, the one I just told you about, my dad's dad said, "I need to talk to you. I need to tell you that you're a special girl." Mm-hmm. And then it went on from there. You know, my brother ended up having a knife under his pillow as a child because he kept getting visitations from my dad but didn't understand it and was really scared. Mm-hmm. So from that day on, I pretty much took it on board. It bubbled away in the background through my teen years, but then it literally hit massively when I was 21 again. I was doing readings for people, and it was awful. I was doing a bit of a party trick, to be honest with you. Not guessing, but looking at someone across the room and saying, right, his name's this, he does this for a living, and they go over and check it out, mm-hmm. and it used to be right. But then the first thing where I thought, wow, I really need to take this seriously, was when I had had a few drinkies in a social club, and a man who had been murdered at a holiday camp came through to speak to this girl who witnessed the murder. And mm-hmm. she lost the plot. And I realised then I had a massive responsibility on my hands mm-hmm. and that this really was real, and that I had to start crafting, you know, my skill, if you like. I had to start learning about it.
Wow.
And so then I just literally found, I went to a psychic fair, and the woman said to me, you don't need a reading, you're going to be doing them, come with me. And this woman just taught me how to hone my craft, if you like, how to learn how to, you know, connect through meditation, how to understand messages. And then I started doing, I was a police officer, and I started doing readings in the evening and using my psychic ability during the day.
Right, okay. And what's the best way for you that you do connect with the other world and the people that have passed? Is it through visions, or is it through things that you hear, auditory? How does it work?
I am very, very lucky. Most mediums out there have a particular forte. They perhaps, you know, they're a clairvoyant, so they see things or they get visions. I'm very lucky that I have all my senses used. So, for instance, I'll give you this man that just popped in my head, who I brought through in a show once, who died because of an addiction of cheese. So he showed me him eating cheese in my mind. I could smell it and I could taste the cheese, and I felt sick from eating so much of it. My stomach was turning, and I could hear him saying, it was the cheese, it was the cheese. And I know this is a really weird conversation talking about cheese, but I can use all my senses, so I can hear, taste, feel, smell, and know anything they want to bring me.
That's
you
amazing.
Know, so
that's
if
amazing.
I see February yeah. written up in my head, I absolutely know it's not my thought and it's to do with something. So then I further investigate it by zoning in and saying, right, well, what are you showing me February for? And then I'll either get, as I say, visions, or I'll get a thought, a feeling, or I'll hear a whisper in my ear. So I'm very lucky that I can use all of my senses. For instance, you know, how someone passes, they pass with a heart attack, I'll feel it in my heart area.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so they basically use everything they can to get the message across to me by using all my senses, which I know is quite rare, because mm-hmm. most mediums mainly work on one channel, if that makes mm-hmm. sense.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the same with all my family. All my family have got the same thing. Plus dream visitation. I get massively prophetic dreams and visitations from spirit people in dreams. It's remarkable how they get to me. But yeah, so I'm very lucky. I can use all of them.
Amazing.
Get lucky.
That's
very
amazing
clever.
Stuff. Well, I was going to move me on nicely to the next question, which is, what's the most important thing to you about being a psychic?
The most important thing for me is bringing the comfort and the knowledge that our loved ones are not just dead and buried and gone. That I've gone through so much trauma. I've literally got an auntie and uncle and some cousins left. Every other family member has passed, some of them tragically and quickly, some of them, you know, not as quickly. And the thing is, I know that losing your loved one, even a pet, it's like the end of your life. You don't want to carry on. You don't want the world to carry on spinning, because it's not spinning with your, you know, with your loved one. And so I've learned that trying to bring some lightness to the biggest fear, which is us losing people through death, is my passion in life. Mm-hmm. If I can help someone or bring them comfort or mm-hmm. assist their grieving in any way, mm-hmm. that's what I live for. I live for educating and proving the afterlife, as well as helping people mm-hmm. get through the darkest times of their life. I pretty much did it in the police as well. I was bereavement trained family liaison officer for murder victim families and rape victims, and mm-hmm. I kind of carried it across when I got retired mm-hmm. to doing it full time, but on a more spiritual aspect, if that makes mm-hmm. sense.
Sure.
So that's why I do it. It is to help people get through the darkest time of their life and to survive, and perhaps even start a spiritual relationship with their loved one up in the spirit world, sure. which is easily done if you try.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And in helping them through, has there been any sort of heartwarming stories that stand out from any of those times?
Do you know
that you've
what?
Helped those
there
people?
I have to say, there have been hundreds over the years. I've been doing readings for over 20 years now. However, there is one that as you've just said that, has stuck straight in my head. No doubt they've brought it to me. There was a lady in the audience who looked broken, absolutely broken. And it was quite a small gathering I was doing. I call them intimate evenings, where it's a small gathering of people do readings for. And her mum, I think it was her mum, came through first of all, and I knew that wasn't the person she needed to hear from, but her mum was setting her in because she was a sceptic. She did not believe in the spirit world. She didn't believe in mediums. She was just dragged along to this evening, and her mum brought her daughter through. Now, her daughter was 2 years old, was in the back seat of a car, and because she was so busy, she hadn't clicked her safety belt in properly. She got hit up the backside by a van. And the baby, I'm not going to get into the logistics and, you know, what happened, but the baby basically died because she wasn't properly fastened. So you can imagine that mum has lived with the guilt of feeling that she'd killed her own child. Mm. Thank God this little girl was such an amazing communicator, being helped by her nan, that she named the car she was in, the colour it was, the time of the accident, her name, what they'd buried with her, where she was buried, what time she was buried, who come and saw her in the Chapel of Rest. She gave such amazing evidence. And one of the biggest things she said was, "Mummy, I am so sad to see you're still sad thinking that it was your fault. I was meant to go to heaven and be with Nanny. You've got to let go of this." And because of the evidence that little girl had given her that nobody could ever have guessed or known, that woman basically changed her life overnight. She ended up getting a job. She was depressed. She was on medication. She was suicidal, and she changed her life. And I remember crying my eyes out. About a month later, she sent me an email saying how I'd changed her life. And now she knew her little girl was safe, that she no longer felt guilty. She was getting help to deal with her grieving, and she was a totally new woman.
That's fantastic.
And to me,
what a wonderful,
that's what this is all about.
That's a wonderful, you know, story. That's fantastic.
Oh,
isn't it?
God, I'll never forget that one. And I cried my eyes out when I read the email. And I have so many of those emails where I've changed people's lives. Not me, but what I've, you know, through my ability, through my gift, I've been able to give them answers that nobody else could give them. And that's what makes me feel so incredibly overwhelmed with what I have, because I can bring this to people. And that's what is my passion in life, is to just keep doing it as long as I can.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, wonderful. That's great stuff. Well, we're just moving into the end of the first half now. So we're going to take a short... Yes, it did go very quick. Yes, very. We're going to take a short break. And after the break, we'll catch up with some more stuff and some more questions for Nicky Alan. So we'll see you after that.
This is Psychic Social, where the world's best psychics tell you their story.
Hi there, hope you're enjoying the show today. I wanted to tell you about QR Tarot. Now, this is a revolutionary deck. This is an absolute game-changing way to learn the tarot. And we've made this tarot deck in conjunction with Nicky Alan, Psychic Medium, and Victoria, Psychic Intuitive. And this deck has QR codes on the back of all 78 cards. So it's got two QR codes, and you scan one for upright and two for reversed. So once you scan the upright code, just take your phone out, get the camera on your phone and scan it, and it'll take you directly to a video of Nicky Alan describing you the upright definition of that card. And then if you scan the reverse definition, it'll take you to another video of Victoria discussing and describing that reverse definition of that particular card. And that is the same for all 78 cards in this classic QR tarot deck. And it's based on the classic 78 card deck with the illustrations by Pamela Coleman Smith, the one that everyone knows and loves. So all you have to do is, literally, it's that simple. Scan it, and it's one fantastic, revolutionary learning experience that we're so proud to have launched with Nikki and Victoria. And in the cards, you'll get the booklet as well, which will give you a QR code on each card in the deck as well. So another 78 QR codes, and you scan that, and that'll take you to an even deeper dive, much more information about that tarot card. And also, what we're throwing in is a free version of our taster course that comes with the cards when you buy them. So all you have to do is follow the instructions in the booklet and the cards when you get them, and you can register for your free version of our taster course. And then we also have got a fantastic deal on the main course of 10 Hour Tarot, and you can find out there what sort of discount you're going to get when you buy the cards. So you can get the cards right now. They're available at psychic.co.uk/QR Tarot. And we'll put the link in the description below. They are on amazon.co.uk and Amazon USA, so amazon.com and you can buy those cards through the website. That'll take you to your relevant Amazon site. And you can also go to Amazon as well, search QR Tarot. So if you head there, you can get yourself a deck right now. They are unbelievable, and you don't want to miss out on this fantastic revolutionary learning experience. Okay, right, now back to the show.
This is Psychic Social, the spiritual home of psychics.
Welcome back to part two of Psychic Social and our chat with Nicky Alan. Now, following on from the last question, I wanted to ask you, were there any, conversely, any funny or hilarious stories that really stood out from you from any of your readings? Anything that really made you chuckle?
There's been so many. Do you know what? The thing is that I love humanity. I'm so obsessed with people and how they work. And the first one's really quick, actually, because you know, you think it's all love and light and all like angels with harps and fluffy clouds and all the rest of it. And I remember this man coming through, and I'm going to call him Terry. And I said, there's a man called Terry here, died of a heart attack, and he wants to talk to his wife. I think her name's Doreen. So this woman put her hand up. I said, over here. She goes, yeah, well, I'd rather you wouldn't, because I hated him. I couldn't stand him. Tell him to go off and go off wherever he came from. I went, seriously? She said, yeah, I can't stand him. I hate him. I went, well, he needs to speak. She goes, I don't even care. Tell him to go away. And she literally hated the ground you walked on. And I'm like, what do you do with that one then? And everybody was just laughing in the end, because the stuff, I can't say it on the podcast, the stuff she was saying, what he got up to, right, was hilarious. So it's a great icebreaker. But the best one that's come to mind, I was doing a demonstration in London, right? And there was this bloke came through. I can't remember his name. Obviously, it's written somewhere in my journals. But he came through and he said, I'll say his name's John, right? I said, my name's John. And yes, this is how I remember it. Because he was drinking a cup of coffee in a cafe out in the open air. And he dropped dead. He had a heart attack drinking coffee, right?
Okay.
So that's going to kind of bring the audience down to one in the audience. And there's loads of people that died drinking coffee. And so I saw this woman. I thought, it's her. And I said, he wants to talk with us, call her Jean. And so Jean, and so this bloke's elbowing the woman. She's going, no. And I'm like, am I with you, John? And she goes, no, not at all. And the husband's looking at her, like sitting next to her, like, what the hell? So I said, he's saying that you lived, and I even had the address, right? I said, did you live in, I'm making it up, Avondale Road? She went, yes. I went, so I'm with you. She goes, no, you're not. This went on for about 5 minutes, right? And this spirit bloke's going, for Christ's sake, I know her. And I'm like, she's saying no. And in the end, because everybody was getting the ump with her, I basically said, you know what, I'm going to leave this, but, you know, he definitely is with you, and he's saying that he really loved you, but don't worry about it, we'll leave it. She goes, no. The husband's looking at her like, what the hell? Anyway, during the half time, I'm backstage, right, in the dressing room. She comes in, she knocks on the door. She goes, Jesus, I cannot believe you just did that. And I said, why? She goes, I was absolutely crapping my pants. I said, why? She said, because I was having an affair with that man. He goes, he lived a few doors down from me, and I'd been having an affair with him for years. We adored each other, but we both agreed to stay with our mutual husband and wife. She goes, so you're telling me all this stuff, and I'm scared you're going to say what?
Oh, no.
You know, how much he loved me, because my bloody husband's sitting next to me. So she goes, I'm so sorry. She goes, but I was having an affair with him, and I didn't want him to know. Oh my God, don't worry about it. So she said, is he still here? I went, well, no, he's got the right hump and he's gone back to wherever he came from. And it was so funny, because everybody knew it was for her. And the husband, he just couldn't understand why she kept saying no.
He's like,
that's John down the road, love. That's John who lived at number 45 or whatever. She goes, no, it isn't. She was absolutely
a bit awkward, yeah.
So the truth can still come out there, even beyond the grave.
Yeah, exactly. You've got to be careful, haven't you, when you're cheating on your partner.
Yeah, but there's been loads of those. So many laughs like that. Oh, my God, so many of them.
Oh.
Especially when I said to someone, I want to feel your breasts.
Really?
Excuse me. I said, I need to feel your breasts. But what I meant to say was, I can feel your breasts, and I can feel that there's a lump there.
Right. Oh, I see. Much
and
more
so
serious.
She goes, it's very
right.
nice you want to touch my breasts, but I don't think it's quite appropriate. I'm like, oh, my God, no, I didn't mean that. So that went down. But do you know what? It's all good fun. Because at the end of the day, demonstrations and shows shouldn't be all maudlin and sad and everybody sitting there. You've got to have a laugh with this, but know when to tone it down at the right time, because you need energy. You need vibrant, positive energy, because spirit people work on such a high frequency where they are that it's almost like tuning to a radio station. You've got to match that frequency, otherwise the show or the demonstration or the reading is going to be a total flop. So you've got to have laughter and humanity in it, otherwise it just
exactly.
doesn't work.
No, you do, exactly. You know? Totally agreed. Now, the next question I was going to ask you is something that I think a lot of people think about, and I think about, you know, a fair bit myself as well. And it is kind of, what are your thoughts and feelings about the afterlife and what happens after we leave
I'm going to say straight away, they're not thoughts or feelings. I know 100%. I've been taken up there so many times and been given the proof afterwards. I've been actually taken to heaven on a number of occasions, which I've said about on my YouTube channel. But I've also written a book about this called Heaven Calling, which I proposed most would be to be my second book out, because I actually I've been shown it since I was a kid. But when my family member died, I said, right, I want to know what happened. Show me the whole process. So what happens is that you're obviously in your physical body. I know, because I get a lot of violent passings and suicides that come over, that we're taken from our body before any trauma happens to our body. So we don't go through the pain. We don't go through the dementia. We don't go through like being killed. We are taken out and almost look at our body and what happens to it, first of all. So that's a really good, hopefully a good comfort for people that, you know, have got family members and loved ones who've died of violent deaths. And we're taken out before the body is subjected to whatever happens to it. We're then taken up. We're normally met by people we know, hence why people shout out family members' names just before they pass, okay? Mm-hmm. So we normally have someone come down and help us. I've also been told to work the angel realms. Archangel Azrael assists us. Archangel Azrael presides over a body just before it's about to pass. He then takes it up. And they're really weird. And I've recently found out that these, because I don't read anything, I don't research anything, I just go by what I'm told by my guides, by the angel realms, by my spirit family. And then if they say look it up, then I can obviously look it up to confirm what they're telling me. They're like little spirit huts that you're taken to, and there's like a cement plinth. That's the best way to describe it. Your soul is laid out on this plinth, okay, and then you're met by Archangel Jeremiah, who reviews your life. Okay, so he reviews how you got on, what you did wrong, what you honoured, because we've all planned what we wanted to do before we come down, how our human experience was, and if we need any healing from anything that's taken place. That's why spirit people heal so much quicker, because they are taken through all of their trauma and it's all ended, and then they're all purified of those thoughts, feelings before the death, and the connections with their loved ones a lot quicker than we are. Mm-hmm. Then what happens is, after the healing process, we're then met by our family members and dogs. I've seen dogs turn up at the plinths as well. And we welcome you and say, hey, hi, you're over here now. And the next thing you know is you're taken to a place called the reality layer, and or what other people know as heaven, okay? And you go to the reality layer, and whatever you loved doing, whatever you wanted to do that you never were able to do, you can. You can create. It's a bit like 24/7 dreaming. You know those dreams where everything seems really real? You can almost taste it and feel it. Mm-hmm. It's exactly what it's like being a spirit person.
Like a lucid dream as such sort of thing.
Yeah. So if you love sailing, you'll be sailing your boat. If you, and the other thing as well, which is really important, is if you've had multi marriages and you think, God, you know, who am I going to end up with? Because I certainly don't want to end up with my ex-husband. You have a defined soulmate throughout your life that you end up with. So no matter how many times you've been married, no matter what relationships you've had, we all know there's the one. All right, we can be married, but there's always one that sticks in our heart. And that ordinarily will be the one you'll end up spending the rest of your life with until you decide to come back down on another reincarnation. So it really is as euphoric as they say. The colours, the dimensions, the pain, the human memories of trauma are all gone, and you are basically a pure definitive spirit there. Some people go and work and help spiritual people down here. Some people work as guides. Some people just chill out and drink beer, and like my mum does.
Read the paper, yeah.
Drinking wine. I dreamt of her the other night, actually, and she was just drinking wine, as she always did, with my granddad in a social club. I'm like, right, okay, nothing changes there. And then they obviously will spend time as much as they can through Archangel Gabriel, as well as because Archangel Gabriel assists them in bringing their energy down to bring messages to you. And that's where they start bringing messages through dream state, or they'll start showing you synchronicity through numbers or signs or playing their favourite music every time you go out. They will show ways of a connection where you think, God, that's my mum there, or Robin will turn up in the garden. You know, all these sorts of things will take place where you start getting weird synchronicities and coincidences mm-hmm. happening. Mm-hmm. And that is the beginning of how you start a spiritual relationship with your loved one.
Okay.
It's never going to replace the physical loss, never no. ever. But I, you know, when my mum died the year before last, and that was Christmas time, so Christmas is tough for all our family, but straight away, as soon as she went, the light bulb went really bright and then dull just after she passed, and that was a sign to say, go on, get out, I'm done now, I'm going up to spirit world. And the way we dealt with it is like someone going on holiday. Do you know, if you've got a friend or a loved one going on holiday, you think, I wonder if they've landed yet, I wonder if they're having a nice time. That's exactly how we view our loved ones when they go over. So we mm-hmm. get over our grieving a lot easier as spiritualists, because we imagine that they've just moved on to the next place mm-hmm. and they're loving it and they're out of pain.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, and they're okay. back with their loved ones. My mum was back with a favourite auntie, back with her mum, back mm-hmm. gardening, back drinking, back doing what she wanted. Mm-hmm. And she looks amazing now when I see her.
Mm-hmm.
She looked so young and so amazing when I saw her night before last in my dream. I'm like, oh, God, Mum, I'm so glad, because she looked like a wreck mm-hmm. when she was ill down here.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, anybody can do this, though. You don't have to be a medium. Anybody can open their minds and hearts to the possibility. And once you send the intent up there, that's when it can all start happening for you. And that, again, is another thing I try and do, is educate people to open their minds and energies up to this, mm-hmm. no matter what their belief or religious system is, and just accept that they are still alive and they are still waiting to communicate and look out for you. Mm-hmm. And they do.
Mm-hmm.
My God, they do.
Yeah. I mean, winding back a couple of minutes to something you said a couple of minutes ago about reincarnation, in
yeah.
terms of that, and in terms of, you know, how many, on average, lives do people, do you think, have? You know, is it just something that just is like a constant loop where people are constantly coming up and down, and are they going to other worlds or places, or what's that all about?
Yeah, not getting too deep with it and trying to keep it layman's terms, which I think that's why so many people can relate to me, is I basically had this come up where my guide, Juliana, said that he'd looked after me and I was a nun called Mary, which is a laugh in itself. Anyway, a nun, oh my God. Right, and that was in 1452 in Trastevere, Rome. I went, oh, really? He goes, yes, that's how I know you and that's why I look after you. And I thought, really? Do you know what? I'm going to sound like a nutter telling people, oh, my guide, and all this rubbish. Mm-hmm. So do you know what I did? I got a ticket to Rome, got in a taxi, said, take me to St. Cecilia's Church in Trastevere, Rome. And I went in there and I found the bust of my guide, and found that the Pope he said looked after us was the Pope that covered that diocese at the time, and realised that I did exist in the house of Mary Magdalena in 1452. And I thought, oh, okay. And then all the other, I've got two more guides, Catherine and Khan. And basically, they have proven through what they've told me and when I've researched it, that where I existed, what I wore and what I did was exactly what was right for that time and era. So that proved to me about the fact that there is reincarnation. And I've seen my previous lives. Some of us are aware of it, some aren't. I'm most probably aware of it, so I can share it with other people down here. There's no given amount of time you want to come down it. There was always a 3-generation gap so that you don't bump into your nan, you know, because mm-hmm. there has been some blips. I don't know if you remember about the little boy who insisted he belonged to a family in Cork that lived by an airstrip, and he was in America, and in the end they honoured it because they thought it would end his psychosis, and it turned out that he knew the family and named them all when he was only a 4-year-old kid.
Right.
So there are a couple of blips in coming down too soon, but basically the way I've seen it, really, really short, is that yes, we can go to different planetary environments that the older our soul is, because I've been to them. We're in such a euphoria, and I'm not joking, right? Once you get over the fact that you're back up with your loved one, you get a bit bored.
Mm-hmm.
It's all exciting to begin with, isn't it? It's like when you come home from holiday, like, oh, I can't wait to see my dog. And then after a while, I think, oh, for God's sake, I've got to feed it and walk it again now.
Yeah.
And it's the same thing. You get a bit bored. And everything is perfection up there. Whatever you intend to do, you can do. And so people crave a human experience. So after that 3-generation gap, the whole family cluster get together and say, right, do you know what? Should we have another human experience? What should we do this time? And we're so sick because we go, I know, why don't you leave me so that I have to go through being left? and then you meet me later on and I remarry you. Oh, and I never had a child before. I'll have a child. And how about this child? You know, I perhaps miscarry the first one so I can go through that experience. And we choose more and more harder challenges the older our souls get for the human experience.
Right.
Believe it or not, we actually plan what we want to do. So when we're down here with our blueprint of what we aim to do, our guides have got that blueprint. And if we're way off course, like I was when I had my road accident, which is a whole another story, they will pull you back and change your life completely. So most people who have a massive life change, on hindsight, look back and think, Christ, it was awful at the time. It's the best thing that ever happened to me. You know, and so, that's guides nudging you and keeping you to your blueprint, basically.
So if you're a really, really old soul that's been up and down quite a few times, you might, you know, you might your next earthly experience might be throwing being in a war-torn zone or something like that.
Yes, absolutely right.
Okay.
Absolutely right. You know, you could end up thinking, oh, do you know what? I want to be a murder victim this time around. You know, I know it sounds sick, but we basically have more obstacles. So, you know when you see these programs where people give up their whole life to, like, you know, rescue animals, and they've got no money, but they don't care as long as their animals are okay, or they voluntarily look after, you know, orphan kids. And you think, Jesus, what are you doing? They've got no interest at all in the material world whatsoever. And they're the old souls. All the young people that are worried about making money, the people you see on Apprentice, the people who care about power, money, and the next Louis Vuitton bag that they can buy, they're the younger souls. You know, the young people that win the lottery, they're getting all of the easy stuff. But the older your soul gets, the harder the challenges get, and the more that you have to struggle down here, because you've chosen it because you want that human experience. And then when you go back up, you're back to euphoria again. You're back to this completely beautiful life, this utopia, you know, with your family. Because basically your soul is eternal, and these tiny little lives that we have down here is like a speck of salt in an ocean of infinity. And so when I have things happen in my life, obviously I've had the worst thing happen when I had this life-altering road accident. However, now when I have anything happen in my life, does it really, really matter that much? Is it worth worrying about? No, because this is a tiny little lifetime, because I know I'm like hundreds, if not thousands of years old. And yes, eventually, once you get to a certain level of acknowledgement or ascension in your soul, you then go on to even higher realms, which gets really deep, different planetary systems, different dimensions and that kind of thing. But I don't want to get too deep, so we'll leave it there.
it sounds like a perfect opportunity for part two with you at some point, Nicky.
Oh, absolutely.
If we want to go into a really, really deep one.
Yep.
Okay. Right, well, let's leave the deep stuff for the moment, and we're going to move on to the more slightly more vacuous stuff, which is, I'm going to ask you, what was the last book you read?
The last book I read, sometimes I try and do a busman's holiday and read spiritual books, but to be honest with you, most of them are quite samey, apart from my one, of course.
Of course, yes.
My one is amazing. Yes. No, but my last book that I read was called Elizabeth is Missing by Emma Healy, and it was absolutely amazing. Sounds a bit depressive, but it was about a woman coming to terms with her dementia and going back to a very, very pivotal time in her life when her sister went missing, and in her current life, a friend she thinks has gone missing. Funnily enough, it's just been put on a TV adaption. It was on the telly the other night. I couldn't believe it. But that was the last book I read. Not very racy, not very sexy, but absolutely brilliant book. Loved it.
Right, great. Okay, and the other thing I was going to ask you was, what about box sets? Are you a binger on box sets? Have you got something that you like? God. Are you all over a certain streaming platform?
Over it, darling. Yeah. Right, I was 5 years bedbound, so I should be the next, like, Jonathan Ross, because I know every film, every box set going.
Right.
Because I've watched a lot of them. However, the one I've just finished, and I've been eking it out, I've been really good, actually. I've been eking it out. But I finally finished it a couple of weeks ago, The Vampire Diaries.
Right.
There is nothing I like more than supernatural, sci-fi, fantasy. Bring it on, bring it on, bring it on. And The Vampire Diaries, oh my God, I loved it.
Is that a bit like...
And I feel bereft.
Right, okay. Is that a bit like Twilight? I've not watched it, but is that
a
vampire
like
thing?
Twilight, yeah. It is so much better than that. It's not as cheesy, and it just involves all different types of phenomena. It's brilliant.
I'll have to look out for it. Right, thank you for that one. I'll just note that down. Where's my pen?
And they're all good looking. Oh my God, girls, the men are lovely, and the girls are lovely. There is eye candy throughout.
I'm definitely noting it down now. Well, it's been absolutely fantastic to have you on the show here on Psychic Social today, Nicky. Before we let you go, can you tell everyone, all the listeners, what's the best way to find you? Where's the best place to find you? Online? Is it your web?
Yeah,
you've got
of course,
a website?
Yeah, online. Online's the best way. I just want to say thank you for having me. I think I'm the first.
Not at all. It's a pleasure.
Really honored to
it's
be
a pleasure
here.
To have you as our first guest on Psychic Social.
Honestly, and I really know that you're going to have some lovely success here. It's a lovely, lovely thing you're
thank
doing.
You.
So thank you.
I hope we do. Thank
me.
You very much.
Anybody can find me on all of the major, you know, social media sites like Twitter, Instagram, LinkedIn under Nicky Alan, NickyAlan. I have a YouTube channel, which is Nicky Alan, which I give lots of card readings as well as philosophy and advice and answer questions. And also, obviously, I'm on Facebook as well. I've got a Facebook page, is Nicky Alan, author and psychic medium, and just my normal Nicky Alan profile. But literally, if you type in Nicky Alan psychic, I'll come up one way or another.
Okay, so, what's the web address of your website, just for the for
it's www.nickyalan.co.uk, and there's a merchandise page for guided meditations that I've produced. I've got my book, Me, Myself, and I, Diary of a Psychic, coming out in May. Which is about my journey from a life-altering road accident that had me bedbound for 5 years, and the miracles that the angel realms of spirit world brought to a very, very faithless young lady. So that's a good read, that one. So
right.
It's coming out May.
Yep, give us the name of the book again.
It's Me, Myself and I, Diary of a Psychic.
Right. Will that be available on Amazon at all, or is it?
Yeah, it'll be on Amazon and all leading bookstores.
Good stuff.
From May 2020. And I'm counting every day and getting very impatient.
I'm sure you are.
Can't wait for it to come out.
Well, it's been wonderful having you on the first Psychic Social podcast show. Thank you very much, Nicky Alan. And
we're
really looking forward to catching up with you in a part two at some point in the not too distant future.
Yeah, look forward to it, darling.
All right.
Take care.
Take care then, Nicky. Thank you.
Thanks for joining us on Psychic Social from psychic.co.uk, the spiritual home of psychics.